We're going to start our study in the Psalms. We're going to be looking at Psalm 1, and I have prepared from Psalm 1 to Psalm 5. I will be giving some details sometimes. I will be just reading sometimes. You'll see that. And the cadence of our study will be a bit different than you're used to on a Sunday morning. But today we'll begin by looking at Psalm 1. Allow me to read verses 1 through 6. Then I'm going to give you some information and then get into the study. Beginning at verse 1, Psalm 1, the writer says, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish." As we begin our study, allow me to give you a background and some information, and this is probably as much information concerning the Psalms that I plan on giving throughout our entire study. But I think it's necessary for us to consider this as we look at this particular book. It's called, obviously, the Psalms. The Psalms are specifically written with worship in mind. As a matter of fact, the Psalms is really a song book. It's a book of songs to God. And as we look at this, we can see this first, that the book of Psalms is the largest book of the Bible. It consists of 150 chapters. The Psalms actually, the word psalm actually means praise. It's later called the Psalms, but originally was called the Book of Praises. The word speaks of poems that are sung to the accompaniment of musical instruments. It's called a psalterium, which speaks of a collection of songs, and that's why some refer to it as the Psalter. The Psalms cover a period of approximately 1,000 years. There are psalms that are associated with Moses, and so all the way back 1410 to about 430 B.C., and there are various writers. You have Moses, who wrote Psalm 90. You have David, who actually is responsible for 75 psalms. Two of the psalms that you see are written by David, but are actually unnamed. For example, Psalm 2 is by King David, but it's unnamed when you look at its authorship. We actually discover that it was written by David by just cross-referencing that with Acts chapter 4, verse 25. Also, Psalm 95 is referred to as a Psalm of David in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 7. You have another writer by the name of Asaph, and the word Asaph means collector. He was a priest and a worship leader who wrote 12 psalms. You're going to see psalms by Solomon, who wrote Psalm 72 and Psalm 127. There are the sons of Korah, who were a part of a composers and singers group, and they wrote 10. You have Heman, who wrote Psalm 88. You have Ethan, who wrote Psalm 89. And then the remaining 50 are basically anonymous, though many of them traditionally have been attributed to the writer Ezra. The psalms are divided into five sections. Psalms 1 through 41 are songs of worship. Psalms 42 through 72, and then including 73 to 89, are songs related to national interests. Psalm 90 to 106 speaks of the wilderness experience of Israel and their wanderings. And then Psalm 107 to 150 are referred to as anthems of praise to God. Question has been asked, who compiled these writings? And actually, we don't know for sure who exactly did, because they were gradually collected over the years from 1020 to 430 B.C. by various men. Traditionally, David may have compiled the writings from 1020 to 970, Hezekiah or Josiah from 970 up to 610, and ultimately Ezra or Nehemiah may have compiled the writings until 430. Now, here's one last thing, and then we'll get into Psalm 1. In the Psalms, we find numerous prophecies related to Jesus Christ, the Messiah. There are no less than 22 prophecies that specifically relate to him found in the Psalms. You'll see that he's spoken of as the Son of God, that he's going to be resurrected, that he will be crucified, that he'll be forsaken by God, that he'll be mocked and scorned, that his hands and feet will be pierced, that he'll be hated without a cause, betrayed by a friend, and even that he will pray for his enemies, and a variety of other prophecies. You'll see this as we go through the Psalms. Many of them contain messianic prophecies. So as we begin, we'll be looking at verse 1. I'll take verses 1 through 3, and then we'll move into verse 4 through 6, and move on into Psalm 2 until we continue and conclude for tonight's study. As we begin here, this is a psalm that is written by an unknown writer, but he speaks concerning blessedness. Notice verse 1, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful." So as we begin, this psalm has been referred to as a wisdom psalm because it contrasts two ways of life. He speaks concerning the man who walks in the counsel of the Lord, and he contrasts that man with the one who refuses to do so. Now notice with me in verse 1 that the writer describes the life of a blessed man by revealing what he does not do. He does not walk with, stand, or sit in the counsel, way, or seat of the ungodly. Now when he speaks of that, walking, standing, and sitting all reveal the progression of falling under the influence of ungodliness. The point he's making is entering into sin is not simply an accident, it's a steady decline. I want you to see that as we look at that. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, stands in the path of sinner, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. It's like a picture of somebody taking a walk. And as he's walking, he stops for a moment. And as he stops there, the next thing you see is him sitting down. And it's showing a picture of how sin can entice you. It's a picture revealing to us that you don't necessarily just fall into a sin, but you progressively move into sinning. And he's saying that the way that can happen is by receiving counsel from those who don't fear the Lord. I can't tell you how often I have shared with my kids, and I don't know if they've learned this yet or not. I think sometimes they appear that they do. Most of the time, I'm not sure. But I can say this. I've been saying to them all of their lives, even as I have said this to myself and I've said this to the church, be careful who you allow to counsel you in your life. Be careful who you allow to influence you in your life. There are a lot of people who go to stores, like Dalton's and others, and they will buy books that are there that are being advertised as answers to your problems. And a lot of people will buy these kinds of books. And they take them home and they read them and they saturate their mind with them. And they begin to follow the counsel of these books. When the scripture says, blessed is the man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. If you need counsel, the first and foremost place you ought to go is to the Word of God. Secondly, you need to remember that the Holy Spirit is referred to by Jesus Christ as the counselor. And then third, if you're going to receive counsel, go to those who are godly, those who fear the Lord, those who have experience in His ways, those who obey Him, those who have a demonstrated life of faith and trust over time. Those are the kinds of people that you could say, do you have a word for me? I have this situation and I need some prayer, and perhaps you can even give me some advice. Those are the people you ought to go to, not somebody who could care less about you. Not somebody who's going to give you bad advice because they're not going to center their advice in the Word of God. And that's what he's speaking about here. I believe that we have to be very careful because sin sometimes can be encouraged by ungodly advice received from friends. That's why the writer says you're blessed if you refuse this kind of influence. It reminds me of Proverbs chapter 1, verse 10. Where the writer said, my son, if sinners entice you, do not consent. Don't allow them to influence your life. Don't allow them to give you influence that's going to take you away from the Lord. Well, what's the answer to this? What's the answer for staying away from bad counsel? Verse 2, he tells us, his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. And what's the result? Well, he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bring forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. What's going to keep me from ungodly influence? Well, he says it. He says, keeping and meditating continually on God's word, not just holding it up or admiring it, but loving it and obeying it. I was speaking to somebody recently who was telling me something concerning a friend of theirs who was making a poor decision. And as we were speaking and they were sharing how this person was going to make this decision, was going to do a certain thing, I said to this person, you know, that's not right. Have you told them that? That what they're about to do is not right because it is contrary to what God's word says. And I was speaking to somebody who knew that this person's decision is contrary to the Word of God. So I said, it's contrary to what God says. And the person I said that to looked at me and said, you know, but they love the Lord. And my response was, Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. That's the demonstration. You see, a lot of people do a lot of things and then say, but I love the Lord. No, wait a minute. Wait a minute. No. If you love the Lord, you're going to obey him. Yeah, but it's difficult. So who said it was easy? Where does the Bible ever say that Jesus laughed all the way to the cross? Nowhere are we ever to be inclined to think that a righteous life is an easy life, because Jesus said, you pick up your cross daily and you follow me. And a cross is an implement of death and humiliation. It's an easy road. It's a wide path. It's a broad gate that leads to destruction. And many there are that go therein. It's the narrow gate, and there be few that enter in, Jesus said, because it is a constricted way. And so how am I going to have a life that is blessed by God? Meditating on his law day and night. Not just reading it once in a while, but considering it. The word meditation can be also spoken of as mentally masticating, mentally chewing on the word and thinking about it, and asking God that it might seep into my spirit so that I might live for him. And so he says God's law is the joy of his light. He says his delight is in the law of the Lord. In his law he meditates day and night. The result, he shall be like a tree planted by rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither. Whatever he does shall prosper. If you want a life that is blessed by God, it comes to obeying the Lord, meditating on his word, and doing what he says. That's the key. How can a person prosper? By delighting in God's word. Because when a person meditates on and obeys God's word, the result will be blessings from the Lord. If you take note, Psalm 92, verses 13 and 14 says, those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bear fruit in old age. They shall be fresh and flourishing to proclaim that the Lord's upright. He is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him. Now the contrast, verse 4. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Now, when he says in verse 4, the ungodly are not so, but are like chaff, he's saying ungodly people, or people who live as if there is no God, do not have the fear of the Lord in them. And without knowledge of the Lord God, they're also without stability in an ever-changing world. And so ultimately, they live according to their fleshly passions, and will not endure. They will not stand. They will not be established or fixed. In verse 6, he says, ultimately, the way of the ungodly will perish. That's because the worthless life of the ungodly simply cannot endure. The Bible tells us, Jesus speaking to those who rejected him, in Matthew chapter 7, verse 23, Jesus will say, I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. So the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. And so we begin our psalm study by seeing that there are two ways of life. There's a way of the righteous that is blessed and prospered by God and is the result of taking his word and meditating on it and doing his will. And then there is the way of the ungodly. The righteous one is like a tree. Its roots are deep into the earth and actually find the living water and are receiving constant nourishment through that and are producing fruit. But the other's not like that. The other's like chaff. It's like when you thresh grain and you have the kernel and you have the husk. The husk is the chaff. And so when the Jew would be threshing the grain, they would take it and they would throw the grain in the air. And as they were throwing the grain in the air, the chaff is blown away by the wind, but the kernel falls down being heavier. He says ungodly people are like the chaff. They're moved by the wind and everything that goes on around them. But the ones with substance are the ones that God blesses. And the way to have substance or weightiness is to meditate on the word of God and to do it. Psalm 2. Why do the nations rage? and the people plot a vain thing. The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, Let us break their bonds in pieces and cast away their cords from us. He who sits in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall hold them in derision. Then he shall speak to them in his wrath and distress them in his deep displeasure. Yet I have set my king on my holy hill of Zion. I will declare the decree the Lord has said to me. You are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations for your inheritance, the ends of the earth for your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron. You shall dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Now therefore be wise, O kings. Be instructed, you judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear. Rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish in the way, when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all those who put their trust in him. This is what is called a messianic psalm, and it describes celebration, the celebration at the coronation of a king despite the opposition. Notice with me that he speaks concerning rebels. Rebels are described as surrounding nations, and they're rejecting the king that is being set over them. And so the point of this psalm is abandon your rebellion against this new king and submit to his rule. Now in verses 1 through 3, the question is asked, why do the nations rage and the people plot a vain thing? You see, the psalmist who is identified for us as David is amazed that the nation plans to reject their Messiah. When he speaks concerning rage, that speaks of commotion and anger. When he says they plot a vain thing, he says their plans are futile and are empty. Now, obviously, this was fulfilled in the rejection of Jesus Christ, who is God's anointed Son. The Bible tells us in John chapter 1, verse 11, that Jesus came to his own, and his own did not receive him. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 1, the scripture says, When morning came, all the chief priests and elders of the people plotted against Jesus to put him to death. And so this is speaking concerning their rejection of Messiah, that they had no desire to have him. But what is the response of God? Well, verse 4 says, He who sits in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall hold them in derision. This is God's response to rebellion. He laughs at it because it's ridiculous. He's the king of the universe. He's enthroned in heaven, and they're rebelling against him. And the Bible tells us in Psalm 115:3, our God is in heaven, and he does whatever he pleases. The futility of the rejection is what causes God to laugh in derision. It's like if you're a parent, and you've got a little guy or a little girl who's 2.5 years old, and they get angry at you, and they raise their little fist at you, and they say, I'm going to beat you up. And you smile, and you say, I don't think so. Well, I magnify that a trillion times over, and that's what the Lord is saying. He's saying, you puny little worms rebelling against me only because you're ignorant of who I really am. And you're rejecting my Messiah. You're saying, we will not have him to rule over us. No, the Lord in heaven shall laugh and hold them in derision, the scripture says. And then, verses 5 and 6, he shall speak to them in his wrath and distress them in his deep displeasure. And verse 6 is the Lord speaking when he says, I have set my king on my holy hill in Zion. So he says, I have set my king on my holy hill. Zion is another name for Jerusalem. And all the Lord is saying here is, this is my king, and you shall bow down before him, regardless of whether you think it's intellectually acceptable, regardless if you want to agree in principle. You see, the bottom line is you don't have a vote on this. Now, that's something that we need to remember. The bottom line is you don't have a vote on this. Let me try and make this as practical as I can. There have been times when I've had a disagreement with one of my kids, and they want to voice their opinion. It doesn't happen anymore, but it did early in their earlier days. And they would start voicing their opinion and all, and there were times when it was just non-negotiable. You parents know what I mean by that. It's just a non-negotiable. And I would say, excuse me. I say, but I don't think you understand. We're not having a conversation. You know, what I'm saying is this is what we're going to do. See, this is not a conversation. You don't, you know, you can have your opinion, but you can basically keep it. because this is what we're going to do. Anybody know what I'm trying to say there? The Lord is saying that. The Lord is saying, oh, you want to vote as to whether I'm the king of the universe, huh? Well, I hate to tell you this, but you don't have a vote. I already am the king of the universe. Now, it's up to you to either acknowledge that or pay the penalty for rejecting it. But the fact stands as is. I am, this is the Lord speaking, the king, and I have set my king in Zion. So you can plot all you want, and you can rebel, but it's a vain thing. Because I want you to know, I have set my king in Zion. And he's speaking of Messiah. And the Bible tells us in Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven, those on earth, those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Now he says, every tongue shall confess, every knee shall bow. And so that's how he's speaking. He's saying, you have no vote in this. This is the fact. In verse 7, I will declare the decree. The Lord has said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me. I will give you the nations for your inheritance, the ends of the earth for your possession. You shall break them with the rod of iron. You shall dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. So Jesus is speaking here in this scripture, and he's saying, I am the Son of God. Now, I want you to notice when it says here in verse 7, I will declare the decree the Lord has said to me, you are my son, today I have begotten you. You might find this interesting. There are two basic ways that that particular phrase is used. One is a recognition of what has been called the incarnation, where Jesus took upon himself human flesh. So there are those who would be saying that this particular scripture refers to that, when Jesus Christ is born of the Virgin Mary. But you might find this interesting, and I bring this out to you because it gives you a different aspect of it. This also speaks of the resurrection of Messiah. Now, you might find that interesting. If you take notes, you can note that in Acts chapter 13. Because in Acts chapter 13, verse 33, we read, God has fulfilled this for us, their children, in that he has raised up Jesus, as it is also written in the second Psalm, you are my son, today I have begotten you. That's speaking of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Romans, in chapter 1, verse 4, Jesus was declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. And so as he's speaking here, it's not simply the incarnation, but the entire ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ is demonstrated to be true in his resurrection. As I was sharing recently with one of our Bible studies, had Jesus died and remained in the grave, then all that he taught would be suspect. Everything that he had to teach was hinged on whether he was resurrected. Had he remained dead and in the grave, even as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, we of all people would be most miserable and also found to be liars because we say that Jesus Christ was resurrected from the dead. If the dead are not raised, then Jesus remains in the grave. If the dead are raised and Jesus is alive, he is the Son of God, and all that he has had to say is true. And so the psalmist is reminding us that Jesus Christ is the Son, and through his incarnation and resurrection demonstrates the truthfulness of what he has to say. In verse 8, when he says, ask of me and I will give you the nations for your inheritance, the ends of the earth for your possession, we are being told that we can go out throughout the world. In other words, Jesus didn't die just for the Jews. Jesus died for the sin of the whole world. Christianity isn't an American or a European belief system. Christianity is for the world, and it was birthed in the nation of Israel. And so we have been called by God to take this out, and the Lord says that he will save people from every nation. Now in verse 10 following, now therefore be wise, O kings. Be instructed, you judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear. Rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and you perish in the way, when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all those who put their trust in him. So he says, you're to serve the Lord, you're to fear the Lord. In other words, submit to the Lord before he judges you for your foolish rebellion against him. It's interesting how he uses the phrase, kiss the Son. When he says, kiss the Son, this speaks of submission to his rule. To kiss the Son is to show obeisance, it's to show respect, and that's what he's saying, given the affection that he deserves. And in doing so, you are demonstrating that you receive him as your king. But, he says, and I want you to see this, when he says, kiss the Son, he goes on to say, lest he be angry and you perish in the way. When his wrath is kindled but a little, blessed are all those who put their trust in him. If we refuse to, then we will be judged. That's the point that he's making. In Romans chapter 2, verses 5 and 6, Paul said, in accordance with your hardness and your impenitent heart, you are treasuring up for yourself wrath in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to each one according to his deeds. The point he's making, either you submit to the Son or you end up in judgment, because I have set my king on my holy hill and you don't have a vote. Either you submit to his lordship, he's saying, or you end up paying the penalty for rebellion. Psalm 3. Lord, how they have increased to trouble me. Many are they who rise up against me. Many are they who say of me, there's no help for him in God. Selah. Now, when you see the word Selah there, it can mean more than one thing. Sometimes it speaks of a pause. Sometimes it speaks of a musical interlude. In other words, these are songs, and it may be that this was a time for a solo kind of thing. And normally it speaks of meditating on this. And so he says, many are they who say of me, there is no help for him in God. Meditate on this. But you, O Lord, are a shield for me, my glory, and the one who lifts up my head. I cried to the Lord with my voice, and he heard me from his holy hill. Selah. I lay down and slept. I awoke, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God. For you have struck all my enemies on the cheekbone. You have broken the teeth of the ungodly. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing is upon your people. Selah. Now, there are those who are opposing King David. And so David is crying out. And they're saying that God has forsaken him. And David's crying out saying that. You see, what had happened is he had been driven from his palace and was hiding out. If you look at Psalm 3 at the beginning, the heading, perhaps some of you have Bibles that have headings. And my Bible says, victory in the face of defeat. And then it says, a psalm of David when he fled from Absalom, his son. How many of you have that in yours, just so that I know? Okay, good. Absalom, the son of David, was a son that David loved with all of his heart. Absalom is told to us in 2 Samuel. Absalom coveted the kingdom. And what he would do is he would actually go into the place of judgment. You see, in Israel, if you were a judge, you would sit at the city gates. And people would come for judgment there. And Absalom, the son of David, would be there at the gate. Now, he wasn't a judge. He just stood there next to those who would have been the judges. And when people would walk in, he'd begin to interview them and say, what's your problem? And they would say, well, I've got this situation. And Absalom would say, where are you from? And they'd say, well, I'm from such and so city. And then Absalom would say to them, you know, if I were a judge, after hearing what you've had to say, well, I would judge in your favor. And the Bible tells us that he did that daily. And not only would he say that, but he would take them by the hand and he would show them affection. He would kiss them. And the scripture says, thus Absalom stole the hearts of Israel from his father David. And what he began to do is he began to build his own kingdom, and he did it from the inside. All along, his father David, the king of Israel, loved his son and trusted him when he was setting up a plot to overthrow his own father. Now, ultimately, he took a couple hundred people with him, developed an army, and he declared himself to be the new king. When his father David heard that that had taken place, David fled from the city and went out into the wilderness. And as David fled with his men and all, he had a few hundred mighty men with him and children and all. As he fled from there, there was a guy by the name of Shimei who was a descendant of King Saul, relative of King Saul. And because David had taken the place of King Saul, because God removed King Saul and placed David there, Shimei had never forgotten that. And so when David was marching out, and the scripture tells us that he was barefoot and he was in humiliation as he was going out, fleeing from his own son, Shimei was there across the way picking up rocks and throwing them at David and said, "You dog, you know, and this is what you get." Now one of David's mighty men who was next to him said, "Why are you allowing this man to do this to you? Allow me to go and take my sword and cut his head off, and I won't have to hit him twice." And David said, "No, allow this, for now perhaps the Lord is allowing him to curse me." He says, "So let's just allow it to be, because if I haven't been wrong, God will bless me, but I'm going to leave it alone." So what he does is he flees. Now when he flees, Absalom now comes in and he tries to reign as king. Yet his father is outside the city somewhere out there, and so he begins to receive advice from one of his advisors. And his advisor says, "Listen, in order to demonstrate your kingship, what you need to do is you need to go into his concubines." He left 10 concubines to mind the house as he was gone. "You need to lie with them in full view of Israel." Because in lying with the concubines, Absalom was demonstrating that he has taken his father's position, even to the point of having relations with his father's concubines. And so that's what Absalom does. He goes out there, and in full view, he sets up a tent on top of the roof so all can see. He goes into the tent with the concubines, and all of Israel knows that he has displaced his father. So David is out there in the wilderness, and people are opposed to him. That's where this psalm comes from. And that's why David says, "Lord, how they have increased to trouble me. Many are they who rise up against me. Many are they who save me. There's no help for him in God." In other words, he's getting what he deserves. "But you, O Lord, are a shield for me, my glory and the one who lifts up my head. I cried to the Lord with my voice, and he heard me from his holy hill." Selah. Think of that. As a warrior king, David understood the protection that was afforded by a shield during battle. And he says, "My God will protect me. He will lift up my head." When he says he's the lifter of my head, "He will restore me to the dignity and honor that I once had and have now lost." So he cries out to God. Instead of trying to get vengeance on his own, he cries out and he says, "God, you see it, you hear it, you know it, protect me. I will trust in you." By the way, the Psalms are great for us when we go through tough times in our life, aren't they? I find myself buried in the Psalms when I'm going through struggles, because these are things I understand to some degree. You're a shield for me. Because a lot of times there are going to be people who may be opposing you. There are sometimes people who may be saying hurtful things or cutting things about you, things that are unfair. The way Shimei was throwing stones and kicking up the dust and telling David, "Everything you're going through, you deserve." Now think about it, because not only did that happen to him, but Absalom ultimately, his son, went out seeking to destroy his own father. But his plans were futile and they didn't come to pass. And he was rushing away from the battlefield, and Absalom had very long hair. And the Bible tells us as he was rushing away from the battle, his long hair got stuck in the branches of a low-lying terebinth tree. And his animal kept moving, and he just was floating there in space. Now, David had said to Joab, his general, he said, "Do my son no harm." And there were many witnesses when he said, "And treat him with kindness." And so somebody comes rushing in and says, "We just saw Absalom. Where is he?" "Well, he's hanging around. He was hanging around outside in a terebinth tree, like a piñata, you know." Well, anyway, I mean, and so as he was hanging there, Joab said, "Did you kill him? Why are you telling me this?" And he said, the man says, "I heard what the king said concerning how to treat his son. And had I killed him, you would be killing me right now." And so Joab got upset and took 3 spears. And he found Absalom hanging there. And he thrust the 3 spears through his heart. And then some others who were there with him killed. They just totally destroyed. And then they cut him down and they buried him and put rocks on him. And what was interesting to me in that is when news came to King David, how he responded. They didn't want to send one of the Jewish runners to let him know, so they sent a Cushite. The Cushite came and David said, "How goes it?" And The Cushite said, may all of your enemies be even as Absalom is this day. In other words, your son's dead. And the scripture says, David began to weep out loud. And he cried out and said, Absalom, Absalom, my son, would to God that I would have died and not you. In the midst of all the pain of a son betraying him, the only thing he could do is weep and say, I would have died in your stead. That's why the Lord said that David, in 1 Samuel 13, 14, he said, David is a man after my own heart, because God sent his own son to die in our stead, you see. And so as we look at this, he says, they are crying out saying, where is your God? Well, my God is my shield. He is my glory. He will restore me. I cried out to the Lord with my voice. He heard me from his holy hill. I lay down and slept, because when you know God is in control, then you have peace. I awoke, for the Lord sustained me. I'm not afraid of 10,000s of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you have struck all my enemies on the cheekbone. You have broken the teeth of the ungodly. Have you ever said that, O Lord, break their teeth? You know, here's a scripture for you. That's a good Old Testament prayer, huh? Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing is upon your people, Selah. God has done this in the past. God will continue to do so. And God will always do this, because God is the one who saves me. Your blessing is upon your people. Psalm 4. Hear me when I call, O God of my righteousness. You have relieved me when I was in distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. It's been said that Psalm 4 is a continuation, really, of Psalm 3. How long, O you sons of men, will you turn my glory to shame? How long will you love worthlessness and seek falsehood, Selah? But know that the Lord has set apart for himself him who is godly. The Lord will hear when I call to him. Be angry and do not sin. Meditate within your heart on your bed and be still, Selah. Offer the sacrifices of righteousness. Put your trust in the Lord. There are many who say, who will show us any good? Lord, lift up the light of your countenance upon us. You have put gladness in my heart more than in the season that their grain and wine increased. I will both lie down in peace and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety. And so continuing, this is a psalm that David is warning his enemies against sinning against God by attacking him. Notice in verses 2 and 3 how he says, How long, O you sons of men, will you turn my glory to shame? So he's speaking to the men who are pursuing him, and he's saying, why are you pushing such lies about me? Why are you promoting rebellion by falsely accusing me of evil? Notice verse 3 how he says, God loves me. He's saying God has set me apart for him, and my God will answer my prayer. That's because the psalmist in Psalm 34, 15 reminds us that the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. His ears are open to their cry. So in verse 4, when he says, there are many who say, who will show us any good? The answer is, abandon your sinful plan and become a genuine worshiper of God. Think about what I'm saying, he's saying, and be still in the Lord. Think about it and be still in the Lord. When he says in verse 6, there are many who say, who will show us any good? Lord, lift up the light of your countenance upon us. You put gladness in my heart, more than in the season that their grain and wine increased. I'll both lie down in peace and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, make me dwell safely. The joy and peace that David has is greater than any joy he's ever experienced, even during the great harvest. You need to remember something about Jewish festivals. There were times when they would have their harvest festivals, and it was a time of celebration because God had once again provided for them. And very often they would gather together. As a matter of fact, they would always gather together, and they would enjoy a great feast and great celebration, and it was a lot of joy for them. And he's saying, what you have put into my heart is greater than any celebration that I've ever experienced in any way in my entire life. And the thing that the Lord would speak to us about this, I think, in a very practical way in verse 7, is to remember that it's God who puts gladness in your heart. I was sharing out of the Gospel of John, and I pointed out to you something I'd like to refresh your memory with. I pointed out to you that Jesus Christ said there are three basic things that I'm going to leave with you and give to you that the world cannot give. Jesus said, my peace I will give unto you. Jesus said, I will give you my joy. And the third thing he said is, I will give you my love. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, he said, if you have love one for another. And I'm going to give you the kind of love that I have. He says, and so when your love is real, you're going to love like I love. He said, and greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. So I give you my peace, I give you my love, but I also give you my joy. Now in the world, there is no such thing as real joy. You can, you know, and I know that there are those who would argue against that, but it's true. What people sometimes consider to be joy in reality is simply happiness, and that's different. Happiness depends on the circumstances surrounding your life. Joy can come even if you're weeping. The scripture says that you can weep all night. He says that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And God said that he will give us something that the world cannot give. So in the midst of your pain, well, you can have a peace and a quiet joy that is beyond anything that you've ever experienced. And that's what David is saying. He's saying, what I have in you, Lord, is gladness, is joy that you put into my heart. Blessed is the man whose sins are forgiven. The word blessed speaks of incredible joy, that you have an incredible joy coming because God has forgiven you. And it doesn't result because we're religious. It results because God has declared us righteous. That speaks of us having a relationship with God that isn't a religious experience. It speaks of being connected to God and have fellowship with him. I can remember the testimony of an individual who was brought to faith in Christ through a man. Some of you may remember his name was Dion. Dion is an old, old rock and roll guy, Dion and the Belmonts and all. And Dion led this fellow to Christ. And when the guy was sharing how he came to know the Lord, I'll never forget his testimony. He said, you know, I used to speak to Dion. He said Dion would be outside washing his car. We were neighbors. And he said, and I was a religious man, but Dion was different than me. So I would ask him, you know, what's going on? And he would share with me. He said, you know, like it was like this. He said, when Dion prayed, it was like he was having a conversation with a friend. He said, my prayers were more like familiar rote prayers, you know, things I memorized as a child to say. But he had a conversation. He said, and in his conversation, he revealed to me something that I didn't possess, and that was a personal relationship with the God of the universe. He said, I had a formal knowledge that there was such a thing as a higher power or a being out there that was greater than me. But Dion talked to him as if they were friends. That's fellowship. And when you have a relationship with God like that through Jesus Christ, then you have joy. In the midst of sorrow, in the midst of pain, in the midst of confusion, you can cast your cares on him because he cares for you. And God can actually settle into your heart a sense of peace and joy that passes all understanding. And that's what David is saying. You have put gladness in my heart more than in the season that their grain and wine increase. I'll both lie down in peace and sleep. For you alone, O Lord, make me dwell safely. Jesus in John 14:27 said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. And finally, Psalm 5. You can hold your applause. Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my meditation. Give heed to the voice of my cry, my King and my God, for to you I will pray. My voice you shall hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning I will direct it to you, and I will look up. For you are not a God who takes pleasure in wickedness, nor shall evil dwell with you. The boastful shall not stand in your sight. You hate all workers of iniquity. You shall destroy those who speak falsehood. The Lord abhors the bloodthirsty and deceitful man. But as for me, I will come into your house in the multitude of your mercy. In fear of you, I will worship toward your holy temple. That word temple speaks of the tabernacle. Lead me, O Lord, in your righteousness because of my enemies. Make your way straight before my face. For there is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is destruction. Their throat is an open tomb. They flatter with their tongue. Pronounce them guilty, O God. Let them fall by their own counsels. Cast them out in the multitude of their transgressions, for they have rebelled against you. But let all those rejoice who put their trust in you. Let them ever shout for joy, because you defend them. Let those also who love your name be joyful in you. For you, O Lord, will bless the righteous with favor. You will surround him as with a shield. This is what is called a morning prayer. And notice with me that David is asking God, please listen as I speak to you. Notice verse 3. Notice how he uses the word morning two times. This is to emphasize that his first morning thoughts are prayer. And obviously, this is a great way to start every day, is to pray to the Lord. And I want you to also notice how he speaks of him. He said, you are my king and you are my God. I was a young Christian when this Psalm 5 became a song that we actually used to sing. We used to sing this song all the time. I won't try and sing it to you right now, but it's a song that I'm very familiar with because we sang it in Calvary Chapel when I was like 21, 22 or so, 23 years old. But this is a morning song. This is a morning prayer. Notice how he says in verses 4 through 6 that God is not a God who takes pleasure in wickedness. And he says, nor shall evil dwell with you. In other words, an evil person will not dwell with God. When he says an evil person will not dwell with you, an evil person will not go to heaven. And look at how he describes what evil is. He speaks of evil as being boastful. He uses the word iniquity. Evil is speaking lies. Evil is violent. And he says evil is deceitful. Those are works of the flesh. Now in Galatians 5, verses 19 through 21, the Bible says the works of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. And Paul said, I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. That's a consistent testimony from Old to New Testament. Evil will not dwell with you. As a matter of fact, verse 6 says, you shall destroy those who speak falsehood. The Lord abhors the bloodthirsty and deceitful man. But as for me, once again, a contrast between the godly and the ungodly. As for me, I will come into your house in the multitude of your mercy. What is it that gives me entrance? Your mercy. Because I have a fear of you. Notice verse 7. In fear of you, I will worship toward your holy temple because I have a reverence of your power and your awesome majesty. Because I know that you are a just judge and that you will righteously judge the earth. And because I know that I deserve judgment and it's a terrible thing to fall into the hands of the living God, I have cast myself upon your mercy, and you have withheld from me that which I deserve, which is your judgment. And it's in fear of you that has caused me to move towards your mercy, is what David is saying. And he says in verse 8, lead me, O Lord, in your righteousness because of my enemies. Make your way straight before my face. He's simply saying, Lord, I want you to direct my footsteps in this fear. There's no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is destruction. Their throat is an open tomb. They flatter with their tongue. Pronounce them guilty, O God. Let them fall by their own counsels. Cast them out in the multitude of their transgressions. They've rebelled against you. It's interesting how he speaks of them. Their inward part is destruction. In other words, from the interior out, they express a lack of reverence for God and a lack of desire for people to be right with him. When he speaks of their throat being an open tomb, now that's an interesting description because it's repeated for us in the book of Romans in chapter 3. And when he's speaking about, he's saying their words smell like death. That's the point he's making. They have no words of life. It's like if you had a body, and I'll give you an example. It's found in Scripture. Lazarus dies. He's there in the Middle East, Jerusalem, right outside of Jerusalem. And he dies. And Jesus is a distance away in a few days. It takes him a few days to come. And by the time he shows up, we all know the story. It's found in John 11. When he shows up, he says, where is he? And they say, well, he's in the tomb. Well, I'm going to go see him. No, it's been 4 days. And it's interesting, the King James, And it stinketh, is what it says. Smells like decay. And that humidity, being in a cave, in the fourth day, the body begins to decay and all. It stinks. And so they're thinking, if you roll that stone away from the mouth of the cave, then from the interior of the cave is the smell of death, rotten decay. That's what he's saying comes out of a person's heart. Listen, all the way back to Psalm 1, blessed is the man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Why is that? Because the ungodly's counsel is death. Because their words will not bring life, that's why. God's word is spirit, Jesus said. My words are life. And there's a fragrance of life in the gospel, but there's a fragrance of death in the world. And that's the point that he's making here. Pronounce them guilty, O God. Let them fall by their own counsel. Cast them out in the multitude of their transgressions. Why? Well, they've rebelled against you. But let all those rejoice who put their trust in you. Let them ever shout for joy because you defend them. Let those also who love your name be joyful in you. For you, O Lord, will bless the righteous. With favor you will surround him as with a shield. Rejoice because God will bless you. Rejoice because God will protect you. And again, Psalm 32:10 says, many sorrows shall be to the wicked, but he who trusts in the Lord, mercy shall surround him. The Lord will favor you. He will surround you. He will protect you. Listen, as we close, what is my great desire for my life? And what could I hope for us? That as we go through this particular book of worship and praise to God, that as we go through it in the way that we are, that we will learn to trust the Lord, to fear him, to depart from evil, and to walk in his counsel. And that we will learn to worship him and to praise him and to glorify him and to trust him and to realize that he is our shield, that he is our defense, that he is our rock, and that he does produce joy and peace if we hold fast to him. And that we would also see the contrast between those who love him and those who hate him. And the result of that, one is joy because you love him, and security, and you will dwell with him, and the other is destruction from his presence. So as we go through these psalms, may the Lord imprint our heart with a greater desire to worship and to know him and to obey him, to meditate on his word day and night, so that we might be like that tree planted by rivers of water, that the fruit will in its own season be born, and that we might, well, as he says, that everything that we do, that it might prosper in him. And that's our great desire, isn't it? So that we might know him in that way.